Welcome everyone to the IEZ session, Data Algorithm and Tools for LCA. And in this, the first, we have three sessions, and in the first one is about, we'll discuss about LCA data. And the topic will be about challenges, opportunities, and consensus of the next generation of LCA databases. And I'm very pleased to welcome all of you and share the information about the session. And we have four speakers today. The first one is Ms. Alicia Boyano Lariba from the European Commission DG Environment. And the presentation title is the Environmental Footprint Database, the EF 4.0. And the second one is from Eco-Event Association, Mr. Carl Van Denbo. I'm so sorry if the pronunciation is bad. And the title is Eco-Event Database, the 3.11 and beyond. And the third speaker is Chris Mattel from the Parc des Sentiers. And the title is A Shared Semantic Vocabulary is a Path Forward for Harmonized Inventory Data. And the last one is Professor Ming Xu from Tsinghua University, introducing the title is Advancing LCA Data for Harmonized Future. Updates on Tsinghua initiative and the database. So let's get started. First, let us welcome Alicia Boyano Lariba from ECDG Environment to tell us about the latest updates and progress about EF 4. Hi, Alicia.
Hi, good morning, good afternoon, everybody. I will share my screen. I prepared some slides. To present, I think that now I am sharing the screen. I will do it in full screen. Yeah, let me know if it is okay.
Yes.
Okay, then without delay, I will start this presentation. So thank you very much for this invitation and this opportunity to share with you on what the European Commission is working on. So we are working on the development of the environmental footprint database. This small presentation has three main parts. The first one is why we are working in a new LCA database, if there are already some on the market. The second one is about the proper development of the EF compliant data sets. And finally, I will say some words on the governance and the IT infrastructure that will host and will make available the data sets to the end users. So the first topic is why we need a new LCA database. And that is the main reason is because the EF methods are increasingly used either in private applications or at policy making use. So we identified three main uses. The first one is to analyze the products and organizations and to foster a reduction of the environmental impacts of the companies. That is what we call a private use. So companies can use the EF methods to analyze the manufacturing process, for example, to identify where are the hotspots and to focus their efforts in order to reduce the environmental impacts either of the organization or the products. The second one is to communicate the environmental footprint of the methods and organizations. We see that consumers are increasingly demand about the environmental performance of products and organizations in order to guide their purchase decisions. And the environmental footprint methods are a suitable tool to do this communication. And the third one is to develop, revise, or implement EU policies and initiatives. So in the last years, we have seen an increase in this use, an exponential increase in this use, not only at EU level, but also at national level in Europe. And we think that the EF methods can bring policy coherence and harmonization. So being the method to be used at the time of showing compliance with these policies. So now that we know why we need a new LCA datasets, I will talk about this. So the database, the EF database, go hand in hand with the EF method. So every time, let's say that the EF methods are released or revised, we are releasing a new or an updated EF database. So we started in 2013 with the first publication of the environmental footprint methods in a recommendation, in a commission recommendation. And at that time, we developed the EF 2.0 database. Then there was a revise of this recommendation in 2021. And we released a new EF database that was the 3.1. The 2.0 and the 3.1 was not properly the ownership of the commission. The commission only acquired a license to be used, and the data providers remained with the full ownership of the commission, with the full ownership of the IP rights. So that was very restrictive for us to use these data sets for the third application. As we have seen, there was an increasing demand on the use of the EF methods in policy development and implementation. And that is the reason why the Commission decided to work on the EF 4.0 database. That will be, at least the core data sets will be the full ownership of the Commission, and that we can use in the three uses that I explained before. So let's say that that is the main reason why we are going to shift to the 4.0, and that will come along with a revision of the recommendation. So there will be certain modeling requirements that will change from the 3.1 to the 4.0. That will happen at the end of 2020, between 2025, 2026 is the expected time. So, but what are the pillars of the EF 4.0 data development? The first thing will be the data quality and consistency.
Hi, Alicia. Yes? Sorry to interrupt. There is a comment saying that can you click on the hide on your screen? Because I don't think we can click on that. So there's a sharing notification at the bottom. On your screen. Yeah, so you can hide it. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Then, well, as I was commented, I want to highlight what are the pillars of this EF 4.0. The first one is the data quality and consistency. So all the data sets that are right now under development are going to be reviewed by LCA experts and the commission as well. They are mainly based on industry cooperation, so it will be the industry who is providing the raw data that will be incorporated in these data sets, and the data sets will be in the future regularly updated. So I will explain a bit later, but the data sets are being created under three formats. The first is fully aggregated, the second one is partially disaggregated, and the third one is fully disaggregated. This will enhance the transparency of the data that are being used to create these data sets. We are going to improve the accessibility. As I have said, right now, we only have the license for use of the EF database 3.1, and that will be and is very restrictive. So that will change in the future. The EF 4.0 datasets will be either open access or accessible, again, a proportional fee, and will be made available to all end users. So people who want to do a PEF study in compliance with a PEF-CR or without a PEF-CR, but also for other applications that research or academia that right now it's not possible. And also, we trust in the past experience of the data providers to ensure consistency among the data sets. And this is a bit an overview of what are the three formats that we are going to have in the database. This is the fully disaggregated. Here we are going to have like information on the supply chains, upstreams, especially, and that will allow the Commission to update these data sets, for example, in the future, or to create data sets using the same model, so to facilitate the creation of other data sets and then improve the granularity of the data sets. So far, we don't know if the fully disaggregated data sets will be made available to the users or not, and we have investigating this point, especially from the legal point of view. We will have the aggregated data sets as we have right now in the 3.1. Basically, is the same as the fully disaggregated data set, but as a black box. We know what is the input and we know what are the outputs, but the best practitioners cannot modify what is inside. And this format will be made available to the users for sure. And we have the level minus one, or what we call partially disaggregated data sets. And here, end users will be able to change at least energy, transport, and some key material and components. And this format will also be available, will be made available to the end users. This is an overview of the type of data sets that we are developing. We focus on those that we consider that are essential for all PEF studies. These are the ones dealing with or in the field of energy, transport, packaging, end of life. And apart from that, we have some others that are not so core data sets, always used, but that there are they have a high demand and that they are on the fields of metals, minerals, chemicals, food, and bio-based materials. So we are revising the list that was published during the call for tender, and this updated list will be published soon as well. And I just the last point on governance and IT infrastructure. We need a platform that will be able to host these data sets, but also to perform all the management and all the maintenance that a proper database needs. And that is why we are working on in parallel on the governance and the IT infrastructure. So we are looking for the ideal house of this database. What we know is that it's going to be centralized in the Commission, so the Commission will have, at least at the beginning, the responsibility of performing all the tasks related to the maintenance, I don't know, review, verification of the data sets, as well as facilitate the submission of these data sets to third parties, and that will be done with the involvement of stakeholders. And we are also looking who is going to be the team to perform this task, if that will be within the Commission itself or in one of the agencies, for example, that is helping to implement the policies of the Commission. And finally, we are refining what is going to be the roles, responsibilities, and procedures for the generation of the data sets, admission, maintenance, management, etc. So, and I think that with that, I finish my presentation, this short presentation on what is going to be the, what we call the EF 4.0 database. Sorry. I thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to reply any question that you may have.
Thank you, Alicia. This is the ministry. Sorry. Thank you, Alicia. And let's finish all the presentations that have a discussion at the very end. So next, let's invite Carl to give us an introduction on the new EcoInvent database. Carl, please.
Yes, good morning, everyone. I hope you can hear me okay. And
yes.
I'm sharing my screen. I hope it's loading. So is it up now?
Yes, we can see the slide.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Yeah, excuse me also, being based in Europe, just like Alicia, I haven't had time to speak much today, so I might be not quite warmed up to give a presentation. It's quite early in the morning still. But thank you very much for this invitation and for the opportunity to present here at the ISIE Day. And yeah, the timing is really perfect. We're really proud to have released this year's release of the EcoInvent database on Tuesday. So this is actually a really nice opportunity to give you a very first brief glimpse about what we've been up to the last year. And also, of course, even though that calls for some celebrations right now, as the old saying goes, after the release is before the release. So we're of course going to have a little look into the future as well as part of this presentation. So just very briefly about EcoInvent, for those who might not be so familiar with us yet. We're an independent, mission-driven, not-for-profit association based in Zurich. The origin of the database traces back to the 90s, and it's already been more than 20 years ago since the first iteration of the EcoInvent project started. It started as a very small organization with a lot of support of the Swiss Federal Research Institutes, but we've now grown to about 80 people, representing something like 20 or even 25 nationalities, with a very wide range of expertises on the team. So the core of our mission is to promote and support the availability of high quality sustainability data. And traditionally, this has, of course, been mainly used for more classic product LCAs, but we're now, of course, seeing a huge increase in the uptake and the application of the data. And as such, we're then now enabling and supporting quite a wide and growing and increasingly diverse ecosystem, ranging from all, from the conventional LCA software to more streamlined LCA and EPD solutions over carbon accounting and product carbon footprinting tools, but also major enterprise softwares. And we also serve as a foundation for national and sector specific database initiatives. And this diversity of application is really important to keep in mind when we get a little bit to the outlook at the end of this presentation. But first, I want to share you a little bit about what we're updating or we're adding to the new version of the database in this year's release. So I will give you some very brief glimpses at the sector updates that have been included. But there is, as usual, also a full report of changes, and we're going to have two dedicated release webinars in a few weeks, where there will be much more information provided for those that are interested. And of course, I would really love for you to check this out and to let us know what you think. I also take this opportunity to thank the data providers, the editors, and also the entire EcoInvent database team for working so hard on getting this this release out. So with that, just have a little quick view on the highlights in the various sectors that we've been working on. So kicking off with energy-related topics, we have built on the comprehensive updates of oil and gas supply that we've already done in the two previous releases to now bring the supply of natural gas and oil up to the status of 2023. Which is really important to reflect then this dramatic shift in the supply chains, especially for Europe, that we've seen in the recent years. We've also improved coal supply chains by updating methane emission factors for mining and also regionalized coal supply in especially Europe and Asia. For electricity, the electricity market has, as always, been updated. Most countries, that is now up to the year 2021. Some countries even up to 2022. And we've also then updated the residual mixes also based on the latest statistics available for that. Moving on to chemicals, batteries, and metals, we've added quite a lot of important industrial chemicals, both the precursors and derivatives of, for example, carbon monoxide, polyvinyl chloride, and various types of resins, and generally improved a lot the representation of the chemical production chains. There's also new new data on composite manufacturing processes. On batteries, new data on lithium ion chemistries, updated data on graphite, and also including new data on more emerging battery chemistries like sodium ion. And on metal supply, we have there both grain-oriented steel, silicon alloyed steel, as well as two grades of gallium production, and also a wide range of minor updates and revisions to the metal sector. Finally, on some other sectors, agriculture has quite a big focus on crops grown in Switzerland with new subregions reflecting the various or the typography of the country. We have in construction more of a Canadian focus. So here there's new data on limestone, cement, and clinker in Canada, but also there a lot minor updates and technical revisions. New data on pulp and paper, mainly in Europe. In transport, we have looked at the passenger car fleet and updated data on that, as well as adding data for aircraft maintenance, repair, and overhaul that we didn't have before. And in waste treatment, we improved regionalization of municipal solid waste treatment in Europe, as well as adding different routes of plastic recycling with data either from Europe or in the case of chemical recycling, actually from China. So last aspect on the update would be the impact assessment methods. And one very exciting news here is the update of, or first of all, the balancing of biogenic carbon throughout the database. It's quite a big task there. But this has now then enabled us to also implement a new version or new implementation of the IPCC method for global warming that allows us also to add characterization on carbon uptake and release from biogenic sources. We can discuss later about the relevance of that as well. There's also been some alignment on the methods and indicators for EPDs on construction materials, and also an update of the Impact World Plus method. So that brings me a little bit to the end, where we'll also then look a little bit beyond this release that we're obviously very, very excited about right now. So here this is not in any way take away the relevance of these important updates and new data that we managed to include in version 3.11, but clearly the demand and the range of applications of LCA data that we're seeing right now requires us to really think about the step change in how we source data, how we manage the database, and how we bring the data out in the world. So for this, I would like to highlight three points where I think it's really, really crucial that we make good progress to be able to meet these needs. And first and foremost is of course, a deeper technical collaboration and data partnerships. We're just one node in the much bigger ecosystem for sustainability data and solutions. And here, Equiment offers a framework for industry and research and sustainability expert to publish data to benefit the entire LCA community and beyond. And these collaborations will be absolutely crucial to continue to scale and improve the outreach of LCA into decision making. But that being said, we also need to work on building a bigger suite of inventory models. This will allow us to have faster updates, improve regionalization, and much more flexibility, especially then to reflect the demands of various standards and guidelines, product category rules, and so on, to suit the various needs and the various applications for this data. And finally, there are a lot of new tools and ways of working coming up. We will certainly hear more in the next presentations. But here we see a lot of potential to enhance the way we do literature review and data set documentation, and also, of course, apply it to improve data and model validation and database consistency, but also to simplify just how users interact with our database to find the relevant data sets and evaluate how well they suit their needs. And finally, also to boost technical support capabilities. So with that, I thank you very much for your attention. I invite you to connect with us, and the easiest way to find the way to sign up for the release webinars is to go to LinkedIn and use the links that were provided in the release announcement earlier this week. Thank you very much.
Okay, great. Thank you very much, Carl, for the presentation. It's very exciting. So just so you know, we have more than 200 people online right now. And for the audience, if you have any questions regarding any of the presentations you hear right now, please put your questions in the chat box, and then we will have a discussion at the very end. So next, let's welcome Chris to give us a presentation on what he's up to. Chris?
Yeah, thank you for that very formal introduction, Li Hao, and hello, everyone. It's wonderful to see so many people from Asia. We traditionally, of course, know that we need to do a better job, including both the China and the rest of Asia in our global supply chain. So I would like to share with you just briefly our idea on how we can do a better job harmonizing and merging data, especially when we imagine the future that Carl just talked about. Thank you very much, Carl, where we do have a broader collaboration potential because we know we need to have everybody on board to be able to get to high quality, scientifically robust decision support. So, one of the problems we have right now is that LCA people are not very good at making up names, but we really, really love to do it. And so we have invented our own taxonomy to describe tens of thousands of different products. And this means that anyone that wants to use our data has to spend an enormous amount of time harmonizing the way that they describe the world with the way that we describe the world. So I'm going to give an example from EcoInvent. This is an extract from a presentation I gave in Sweden earlier. And I'm going to make the same joke I made there, which is there are two types of databases, the ones people complain about and the ones nobody uses. So let's complain a little bit about EcoInvent. So here are the names that are used for steel products in EcoInvent, at least in version 3.10. This does exclude a few sets of very specific steel manufacturing processes. Now, what's the problem with this? So there isn't a logical consistency in what gets included and what doesn't get included. You can see that we have, for example, stainless steel, but we have very specific types of some types of ducting. And there isn't any good reason that I can think of that we would want to have some level of detail in certain areas versus and very coarse level of detail in other areas. So what would be an alternative? So if you think about how people trade products and especially how they assess tariffs, they have to classify goods following the HS tariff code, that's harmonized system. And the European Commission has come up with a more detailed classification scheme, which they call the combined nomenclature. So here's an example of a selection of the stainless steel products, which are in the combined nomenclature. This is a wonderful database because it's published in a computer readable form. It's also updated every year and is published in multiple languages. So this has quite a lot of detail, and the detail is based on the needs of people actually trading goods back and forth across countries. which means that it does do differentiation when it seems clear that we have economic differentiation. And we know that economic differentiation is also a good predictor of LCA-related differentiation. And of course, this is organized as a taxonomy. A taxonomy is a hierarchical system. That means that you can have broader classifications like metals, steel, stainless steel, and you can go down to quite a lot of detail. And I said before, it's also available in other languages. So we have, is this available in Swedish, but also in all the other, it's provided in all the other official European languages, but of course nowadays it's not so hard to do translations. That doesn't mean that we see LCA data providers providing things in other languages. One really nice part about a taxonomy is that we break the current way that we're building unit process data sets. Anytime we're going to build a unit process data set, whether it's against EcoEvent or EF or whatever, we have to adapt to the way that they describe the world. And this means that anytime we want to do updates, for example, if we do have newer data coming in, which is more specific, or if in general, if we just want to be more precise in the things that we need when we build a unit process inventory, we really can't do that. So a taxonomy allows us to break this sort of disjoint between our paradigm and their paradigm, because you can specify in the exact level of detail what product you need. And then at runtime, in other words, at calculation time, this will be linked to the closest available provider of that product, even if it is going from, you know, some very specific cold form steel bar that goes up to generic stainless steel. That's an approximation where we know that we do this all the time, but let's do it in a way that, for example, in the future, if a new supplier does come in, then we would be automatically linked to this more specific supplier. We can, because this is described using the semantic web, we can, under a certain ontology, so we're using SKOS, Simple Knowledge Organizational System, we can add in additional types of descriptors, which allow us to describe relationships between different products. So we don't only have to use the combined nomenclature, we can annotate that with links. Here I've showed a description how we can annotate that with a link to stainless steel as provided in the EcoEvent glossary, but we could do a similar thing with EF or whatever, LCA Commons or whatever background or Jiangong or whatever background databases we are interested in. And this become sort of a neutral common language upon which we can describe the world while still allowing us to do calculations using whatever background system we want. And that also can open up the possibility of describing a system using this neutral background and then doing calculations using multiple background databases as a form of coarse sensitivity analysis, which may be quite useful and interesting for people. And because this is described using the SKOS ontology, we have very precise descriptors of allowing us to describe what that relationship actually means. Is it an exact versus something which is related and broad and narrow is their way of describing things which are either more coarser or more narrow, more precise. Of course, because we don't have to only take the combined nomenclature, we can add in some additional data. So here I have in mind that we could add in specific technical standards based, for example, on DIN, ISO, EN, all these different standardization organizations that allow us to be even more detailed, even more precise in exactly what it is that we're talking about. And we don't have to only do this with products, we can do it with processes, we can do it with locations, we can do it with units. And here we've already started developing not just the database, but also a set of web services that allow us to do, for example, unit conversions. And these unit conversions are not just converting kilograms to how many earth masses that is, but it can also include, so we've already done, for example, including all the base units which are in SEMA Pro, all the base units which are in EcoEvent, and allowing us to convert from the descriptors that those individual systems have across each other. Right. And so because we have a client library, we can traverse the different hierarchy going up and going back down. We can imagine including international standards, and we can imagine doing the same thing for elementary flow. So elementary flows are one of the main places that I pull my hair out lately. That's because we have, for example, SEMA Pro has its very own unique way of looking at the world. OpenLCA has its own unique way of looking at the world. EcoEvent publishes a glossary, which is already a huge step forward, but it also has its own peculiarities. And trying to match these is very difficult, particularly because we just don't have that much information. So if we imagine using systems like ML or AI, we don't really have a good amount of information to be able to train or to be able to feed into these systems to do automatic matching. So here's a table on nickel, a nickel ion, so the cation plus two. And you can see that there just isn't that much information. And even the information that we do have, for example, Econet 310 has synonyms which say that this is equivalent to nickel. And that could be misleading in a case that we're looking for example, do we want to match it against all the different possible nickel cations? We can also see, for example, that the descriptions of the CAS numbers are not provided. They're correct, but they're not consistent one with each other because there's different normalization forms for the CAS number. Right, so what would be alternative here? Well, like for products, we look at combined nomenclature. For elementary flows, we can look at the CHEBI database. CHEBI stands for Chemicals and Entities of Biological Interest. And this has exactly what we want. It's kind of shocking we didn't use it at the very beginning. So in addition to describing, for example, all the different cations of nickel and all the other parts of nickel that might be interesting for us, it includes a lot of different chemical properties. It describes what these systems are. So I'm just going to show you all the different data which is available for nickel 2 plus. And imagine if we were going to then apply AI against all of this information, we would be able to do our matching, especially our automated matching, with much higher degree of certainty, a higher degree of confidence. And we would be able to additionally annotate these CHEBI databases. If there are things which are missing, which are relevant for LCA, the CHEBI does have a form where you can suggest to include new entities and how you can describe those entities and their relationship to existing entities. So we think that CHEBI would be a huge way forward, and we're trying to do crowdsourced fundraising to be able to enable us to not only to annotate existing LCA elementary flows in the CHEBI database, but be able to provide this as a web platform and a web service with a client librarian. And if this is something that you or your institution would be interested in contributing to, we're not looking for 20 euros or 50 euros. We're trying to raise around 50,000 euros. That's what we think it would take to actually implement this for thousands of elementary flows. You can look at our proposal here. This is run by DDS. DDS is another Swiss association. It is one that you can join. It's 25 euros for academic people and 50 euros a year for people who have already graduated from their studies. That allows you to participate in the General Assembly, take votes, and make decisions on what DDS as an organization should do. This is not my ideas. These ideas were developed by a broad team of people over a series of retreats and workshops. So very much a big thank to everybody there. And with that, I'd like to say that if you are interested in funding open source development, please check out our business website at cauldron.ch. And otherwise, thank you so much for the invitation or for your attention.
Thanks, Chris. That was very exciting as well. So the last presentation is mine. My computer is still not working. So I will ask my colleague, Jin Chuan, to share the screen and I will present from my cell phone. Jin Chuan, can you share the screen?
Yes, just a minute.
Well, so basically, What I like to share is to the updates on the Tiangong initiative and database that we are working on. So for many of you have heard about us, we are trying to work on an open and transparent lifecycle assessment background database for China, which is called Tiangong database. The name of Tiangong came from an ancient Chinese book called the Tiangong Keiwu, which described the industrial system in China in about 400 years ago. So next slide, please, and we can skip this next one. So it's a community-driven, non-for-profit project led by us, but working with 43 universities across the globe, mostly in China, but also people outside China. There are totally about 180 people working together to develop and maintain this database. We released the database on November 27th last year, and the country has about 15,000 unique visitors and more than 20,000 downloads. So we have already shared the data with through SUDA for LCA. So if you are familiar with SUDA for LCA, you can find us there. And we're also part of GLAD, United Nations GLAD platform, and hopefully we're working really hard to meet the LCD in European Union LCD in requirement, and hopefully can be part of the LCD in near future. And the funny thing is that during the process of developing the data, we have found that the existing software, for example, OpenLCA, et cetera, cannot support our curation of data and making data compliant with ILCD or EF standards. So we developed a software ourselves for the data curation process. And this software will be open sourced and will be made public in next couple months. Next, please. So the next step for us is first we are working on to improve the data from unit process level to lifecycle inventories, and also develop open source tools, the one we mentioned before, and also including other tools that we're also hopeful to develop. And all those tools, I think we will make them based on the AI. AI infrastructure. And then finally, we would like to connect with a global community to help to develop the open source community like Chris just envisioned. Right. So next, please. So we think that there are three major challenges for LCA data that, as some of speakers already mentioned, isolation caused by software, et cetera, and errors and information loss during data transformation, and the next, inconsistent functional data also hitting the interoperability. And then next, please. Next. So we really want to call for a global cooperation on promoting the data harmonization and the interoperability. First, we need we have three proposals for people to discuss. First, we should build a unified, open, and shared data framework. Right, a lot of the reasons that have already been mentioned by previous speakers. So next, we think we should have a global recognized infrastructure in terms of guidance, rules, standards, in terms of one central reference data package, and also collaboration by global community. Next, I think we should really promote open source software. On the one hand, that's because I think that's a trend in the whole community. And second, I think it's also a way to address the digital gap between different countries and regions. Right? Open source software will be accessed by most of people. Right? So finally, I'd like to just thank you all for attending, and thank all the speakers. And let's have the last 15 minutes for discussions. There are a lot of questions in the chat box, but I hope we can utilize, we don't have too much time. I hope we can utilize this time to be more strategic. For many of those questions that are very technical, I think we can find answers somewhere else. And so I'd like to first just bring a question to the speakers, especially Alicia. So if, for example, Chris and us and the Eco Event, if we are developing open source softwares, open source data, and what would be your opinion from a governmental agency's point of view for open source tools or softwares?
Well, this is my personal opinion. I cannot say that that is the opinion of the European Commission, because I will have to consult my colleagues, especially legal advisors. For me, in principle, open access is a way to facilitate the implementation of LCA studies among in the companies and somehow to trigger or to support the use of these studies to have a reduction in the environmental performance of the companies and in general the products. So I would be me personally in favor of having them as open access.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Great. And for Carl, since EcoInvent, even though EcoInvent is a non-for-profit organization, but EcoInvent database is there is a fee for database. So what do you what's your opinion, your personal opinion, and also perhaps the EcoInvent opinion in terms of open source?
Yeah, well, I think your initial question was on the open source softwares or the tools for interacting with data. And of course,
yeah,
we want to serve our data to whatever platform or tool or software that users need to do their work. So that way we're completely agnostic. And as probably most know, the data can from EcoInvent that can be found in pretty much any major LCA application out there. The other question is about the data, because there might be open data, but there's certainly no data that comes for free, and it certainly doesn't stay relevant and get maintained for free. So right now we have a business model that is of course based on licensing our database to be able to fund the work that goes into improving and maintaining it. And that has been a model that has worked really well up until now. But of course, as we move into the future with a completely different set of demands, but also opportunities for how to gather and process data, that is of course not something that is necessarily for forever. But it is crucial to stress that, and I think everyone here on the panel will agree, keeping LCA data, gathering it, compiling it, and keeping it relevant is certainly a lot of work, and tools will help that, and new technologies will help that, but it certainly is still a very demanding task, and that needs to be funded one way or another. I think that would be my response to that.
Oh yeah, of course. Yes, that's I totally agree. I think the open source data and commercialized or proprietary data can coexist in some way. So there is a relevant question in the chat box. I think it's important. What is the relationship between EF database and EcoInvent database? Well, will EcoInvent database, Gabby, or other database be included in EF? How can individual institutions get their data set be recognized or approved by EF and EcoInvent database? So I think Alicia and Carl?
I can reply first on the EF database, and then I will pass the floor to Carl. So for the EF datasets, well, so far, EcoInvent database is independent of EF database. We don't know what is going to happen in the future, but how it is set right now is like this. There are two databases that are independent, one the other one. In the EF database, it's possible to accept datasets developed by third parties, by companies, for example. We have a procedure of acceptance, so we have to check that they are EF compliant, and for which users these datasets can be used, And if there is anybody interested in this procedure, please send me an email and I will explain case by case how to proceed.
Okay, Carl, about EcoInvent?
Yeah, so maybe one thing to mention is that EcoInvent has been part of consortium that have contributed data towards the previous phases of the EF development. So we're not currently involved in the consortium in preparing version EF4, but we have had data either derived from existing EcoInvent data or creating completely new data for the commission in the past. So we have built up the experience of moving data, let's say, from one place to another. And generally speaking, of course, we follow the developments in the European Union to make sure that our European users and anyone affected can continue to rely on EcoInvent as a resource for LCA data. But as Alicia said, this is two separate things, but of course, very closely connected by proximity and of course, with the objective of bringing data out to people to make more sustainable decisions ultimately. So that's I think in a nutshell.
Okay, thanks, Carl. So Chris, you during your presentation you mentioned you touched upon open source tools to address questions, issues in the LCA space. So what do you think, can you give us a more comprehensive picture of what you think open source software tools can play in the existing current LCA world, in terms of, data curation, in terms of calculation, in terms of reporting, etc.
Yeah, sure. So I think for some people, open source is a moral question, but for the majority of the community, open source is more of a practical question. So is this a better way to harness our collective knowledge, our collective experience, and our collective ambition? So I do think that to get to the level of high quality and scientifically robust decision support, we need to make it more easy for everyone to participate in inventory data generation, inventory data quality review, and ultimately in understanding where we need to invest resources to better understand the world. I'm not sure anyone should be really happy with the current state of data. I think the tools are also a combination of legacy tools and academic proof of concept. So I would include, for example, the framework I've been working on for over almost 15 years now is still much more a proof of concept than a really robust tool that can be used every day, especially if we imagine sort of the data pipelines that we want to support going forward. I think being open is a good, like we've seen that in the case of Brightway, being open is an absolute prerequisite to be make sure that the software is addressing all the different needs of the community. If something is closed, then nobody has the opportunity to contribute code to be able to file detailed bug reports because they can't understand where the problems are coming from. But I think when we imagine the world that Carl talked about, that's also my vision, moving away from the idea of unit processes towards these inventory generation models, then we absolutely have to have those as open source because we want to have debates over the scientific merit of the individual formulas, the value judgments, the different types of choices which are being made. And being open is the only way to understand that. I also think that we shouldn't forget the lessons of the COVID pandemic. So not in every country, but in a lot of countries, people were highly suspicious of quote unquote expert judgment. And I don't have a good way to overcome that particular problem, but definitely being more open, being transparent and being honest about what we can say and what we can't say is one way to help make this so that we don't have a big backlash against the idea of being more sustainable in the long term. I don't think that we should overlook the elections that have happened, not just in the US, but all around the world, where there does seem to be some questions over whether or not we need to address these sustainability challenges.
Yes. Well, I totally agree. So, but I think, you know, open source software, open source tools, obviously will have a lot of to contribute in whatever we are trying to address in the LCA space. But at the same time, the traditional way of curating data, processing data, making data available to the customers through a license, I think it still has its value. I you know, personally, I think in the future there will be a world that all those different commercialized software and tools and open source software tools could be coexist for a certain period of time. And I see, Chris, you are already helping people to answer their questions in the chat box. And I see there are a lot of other questions coming, and some of them are very technical. And I think we can record those, save a copy of those questions and send to our speakers, and then find a way to share with whoever is ask the question. So we have about 3 minutes left. I'm not sure if Chris, Alicia, and Carr, you have any final comments want to share?
I would like to thank you again for this opportunity to present our work. I think that is also the opinion of my colleagues here. And as you say, we're able to reply your questions you sent to us in writing.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Anything you want to say, Carl?
Yeah, also from my side, thank you so much for gathering this session and for giving us the opportunity to speak. I think it's really important to keep this exchange going, and for sure that's how we're going to hopefully start addressing some of these major challenges that has been raised today. Thank you very much for this.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Chris, any final comment?
No, just thanks for the opportunity, and feel free to get in touch.
All right, okay. So for some of the logistic questions I see in the chat box, so the recording will be shared by the organizer of this event, which is the International Society of Industry Ecology. I think it will be on the YouTube channel of ISIE, International Society for Industry Ecology. Please check that out. And the IE Day is a global 24-hour event that will have other events after this. Please check out if you're interested. And this 1 hour event is one of the three parts that we organized. There are another two talking about AI application in LCA, and I think data in LCA will be in other time, which you can check out from the IE Day program, right? So this is about the end of this session. So I'd like to thank everybody again for participating, especially thank for our speakers, Alicia, Chris, and Carl, for participating in this event and share your insights. Right. Thank you, and bye-bye.